it's less simple. It's basically designed to get people back on track. Right in the front of the book, this said, the information of this manual was born out of a heartfelt desire to put something in place in my own ministry that would set forth the most important things in the kingdom of God, things that are supreme importance to God and things that God is primarily interested in. Many of us are moving frantically in diverse directions with varying intensity, but sometimes I wonder if our moves are ordered of the Lord and reflect God's interest. Everyone that is born again is not interested in what God is interested in. Not all ministers, not all pastors, not all leaders are interested in the things God is primarily interested in. The three primary interests of God are that souls are saved, believers are filled with the Holy Spirit, and for believers to grow up spiritually. Reflecting upon the things that are primary concern of our Heavenly Father, I was drawn back to the life and ministry of Jesus. After all, He came to show us the Father and to make known His ways and His interests. Jesus' example undoubtedly is one we must emulate, and His path is the path that we must follow. His purpose is our purpose, His plan is our plan, and His mission is our mission. We are to be like Him, we are to walk in His steps. And so that's kind of basically the foundation that we are going to build on, having God's interest at heart. The scripture text is found in Colossians 3, verses 1 and 2. You can turn there, Colossians 3, verses 1 and 2, and Philippians 2, 19 through 21. Today's our first day, so we've got to get off to a slow start. I have 24 on my list. So, we've got 27. I might have to send Brother Joyce looking for them.
That's not here, huh?
But sometimes you have to deal with people. One-on-one before you can get the response, and sometimes you might have to find the best time for them to come. But Colossians 3, verses 1 and 2, it says this: if ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. So that's a good scripture to start with, that if we be risen with Christ, we are to seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand. In other words, the things above are the things that God is primarily concerned about. And it seems like God would be interested in, he is interested in our financial well-being, our family well-being. Interested in helping us and ministering to us when we're down. But God's primary interest is an eternal interest, because after we go through life and enjoy the blessing that God has made possible for us, then there is a life after this life. How many know that the life after this life is over is going to be much longer than this?
Hey,
it is. We live to be, I guess, you know, we was that average 60 or 70, I guess.
Three scores.
Right. But after this life is over, immediately after Jesus comes, that would be the beginning of a 1,000-year reign. You know, He's going to come for the saints first, and then a few, a little while later, He's going to come back to the earth to set up His millennial reign. So He's going to be on this earth 1,000 years, and we're going to be reigning with Him. But we'll be in glorified bodies. bodies that won't decay, bodies that won't ever grow old, bodies that won't be limited by time and space. But the thing is, after the 1,000 years is over, we're going to be recommissioned, and we're still going to continue our reign with the Lord after the 1,000 years is over. We're still going to be, amen, in the kingdom of God, and we'll have assignments, we'll have responsibilities, we'll be doing things, we'll be existing, we'll be glorifying God, and all of the things that we do now, plus more. So, you know, it seems like this life is just so short compared to we're going to live with God forever. It seems like to me, common sense, but you know, we don't, I guess common sense is just as uncommon as, you know, as it is, because people just don't think about the eternity, they don't think about life after this life. Most people think about what?
Life right now, what's right going now. On down here,
right.
And they don't know that we're supposed to be preparing for life afterwards,
right.
While we're here on this earth, because this
right.
is not a permanent place.
Right.
We're supposed to be preparing for eternity while we're down here, if you don't understand.
Right, that is good. So the only way, how can we get people to understand that today? And to get in that mode.
Have to
deal with people, right?
Yeah.
And that's my job.
Everybody's
it's a big job, right?
Yeah.
To get people think in terms of life after life, to get their affection on heaven now, that is a big job. So on Tuesday night, we're talking about life. Well, the judgment scene and how God will judge us as to the things that we do while we're living down here on this earth. The judgment scene of Christ, all of the different things that's going to come to play in the judgment. So that is a sobering teaching as well, how God will judge us. He'll judge us according to how we use our time, how we use our money, how we use our resources. How we use our abilities. So, it's 70 years or 80 years or 100 years or whatever, it might not be that long, but a whole lot hinges on that, because that will be the time that God will determine what you will be, what you will do, and the consequences you will face or whatever after this life is over. So that's very, very important. So I think it's worth searching out and worth thoroughly understanding the things that God is interested in. And I think it will pay all of us, because in the judgment, we're going to be paid, you know, we're going to be paid according to our works. As I said, our faithfulness, it will be our willingness to suffer for Christ's sake. The attention that we directed towards souls in terms of being concerned about people within the church, people without the church. All of these things are going to come into play. Also, today I mentioned on sanctification and holiness, how we control our flesh. You know, how we control our flesh and overcame sin. Our struggles with the temptations and all of this, how we dealt with that. We're going to be rewarded according to things like that. And also, in terms of being hospitable and giving, whether we reached out to the poor and helped people that were less fortunate. And I know that the Jewish people, a lot of their blessings. In other words, they're going to be judged according to how they to other nations and let nations that reached out to them and ministered to them, like during the tribulation period, when they were really persecuted, the Jewish people are going to be really persecuted during the tribulation period. And nations that were nice to them, that were cordial to them, that ministered to them, came to them when they were in prison, fed them when they were hungry, and ministered, gave them clothes and things of that nature. They're going to be they have to be saved, but that will be a part of the criteria for them to be accepted in the kingdom. Because when Jesus comes back to the earth to set up his millennial reign, he's going to judge everybody that's still alive. And the nations that received Christ during the tribulation period and the nations that were friendly to the Jewish people, they're going to be accounted worthy to enter into the kingdom. They're going to walk right into the kingdom for 1,000 years reign in their natural bodies. So, it's a whole lot hinging on really being interested in the things that God is interested in. So, the first scripture is dealing with setting our affections on things above and not on things of the earth. The second scripture says, but I trust Philippians 2:19-21. But I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timotheus shortly unto you, that I also may be of good comfort when I know your state. For I have no man like-minded who will naturally care for your state. For all seek their own, not the things which are Jesus Christ. Now turn over to page 16. That scripture is kind of broken down. And I have under... having God's interest at heart is not automatic, but something we must seek to know. I have A and B. I'm just going to read that. Having God's interest at heart does not come with the new birth or what our ministry call. It will remain hidden until discovered and sought out. So we can't blame believers that much for not being concerned about getting people saved or getting them filled with the Holy Ghost, or getting them built up or established in God, because it doesn't come automatically when you first get saved. So what do you think you have to do in order to get God's interest kindled or activated in your life? What do you think you have to do? Because there's just only a few people that's really interested in what other people. Amen. Most people, as you know, would be people that are they're busy, they're involved, they are doing things, you know, for themselves, and they are preoccupied with things of this life, worldly pleasures, and as somebody said that the abundance of idleness, and you know, as today we were mentioning about watching TV for long hours, but many times we don't do a wholehearted any time for the things of God. And this is a serious mistake, very serious. We just have to keep admonishing people that we got to do things that will affect eternity, our eternity. We got to focus on things that God will base our future throughout eternity. He's going to base everything on what we do in this life. If you're not faithful, if you're not committed, if you're not even interested in the things of God, then in the next life, man, he's going to, the consequences of that will be reaped. Okay, let's look at that. It doesn't come with a new birth or without a ministry call. There's a whole lot of people called to be ministers and teachers and missionaries, but some of them are more interested in what? Showboat. Right? You're seeing, receiving glory. call missionary so-and-so. $50. They're interested in things that don't matter, that means a hill of beans in this, and you know, in the life to come. Okay. It will remain hidden until discovered and sought out. All right, so It's something that we have to do in order to cause the interest that God wants us to have in others to be kindled or to be activated in our heart. All right, Paul points this out in Philippians 2, 19 through 21. Now, he was dealing with a whole lot of ministers in his entourage. I'm sure that he had a whole lot of ministers that were saved and working under his ministry. But this is what he said. But I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timotheus shortly unto you, that I also may be of good comfort when I know your state. For I am no man like-minded who will naturally care for your state, who will be genuinely interested in your welfare and devoted to your interest. For all seek their own, not the things which are Christ Jesus. For the others all seek to advance their own interests, not those of Jesus Christ. Now, here's the notes behind that. Paul had many fellow laborers in the gospel, but Timothy was the only one that seemed to have had a genuine interest in the welfare of the saints. He was completely devoted to their care and their spiritual progress. Note two, when an indictment against God's representatives and ambassadors, so what in an indictment against God's representatives and ambassadors whose role is to speak on the Lord's behalf and to represent the Lord's interest. Look, in other words, Paul was saying that of all of those preachers and ministers that were saved under his ministry that at this particular place, he said that he had nobody that had the mindset of who Timothy. And he was the one that he always had to send into churches that really needed to be ministered to. Timothy was the one that was very faithful. He said, I have no man like-minded who will naturally care for your state. In other words, who will be genuinely interested in your welfare and devoted to your interest. For all seek their own, not the things which are Jesus Christ. For the others all seek to advance their own interests, not those of Jesus Christ. Okay, what a situation. And that's very much like conditions that prevail today. Most people, you know, even leaders, you know, I travel quite a bit. Most leaders are not going to be interested in things that really pertain to the needs of the people. They're going to be interested in their titles, their positions, the money that they're getting. They're going to have motives which are not pure and right in the sight of God. You know, sometimes it's kind of hard to find a person that's genuinely interested in God, period. Most people are interested in what? Themselves.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah, what's in it for me? So they're not seeking the interest of those that are in need, those that have challenges, those that need to be taught, those that need to be prayed with and cared about. They're interested in only the things that pertain. It's not wrong to be interested in things that pertain to you. Amen. Because all of us got things that pertain to us that we got to what? Care for. Okay, now there's a scripture that we often hear about, take no thought for your life as to what you should eat and drink, and what you should, you know, whereas, you know, with what you should be clothed. That doesn't mean that you don't make no plans or no provisions for things that pertain to your own personal affairs. But things that pertain to our personal affairs, needs, home needs, children needs, family needs, and personal needs. Those things are very, very important. But we are not to do that at the expense of what? Putting God first in our lives. We're to make plans. We're to take care of our families. We're to do all the things that we're supposed to do for our family. But when you begin to just focus on that alone, God is not in the picture, we we don't have time for God, amen, then I don't think that you can adequately be that good of a what? Provider and protector. And a person that can really set the standard and bring the fear of God into your home. Because the ability to put the fear of God into your home and set a precedent for your family is contingent upon your fear of God. You got to put God first. Otherwise, you're not going to have the wisdom to do it. You're not going to have the strength, the ability, the anointing, and the spiritual insight to do it. So everything really hinges on putting God first and placing the things of God at the top of your list. Now, I understand this calls for a whole lot of planning and organizing. You just don't jump up and do all of this. You got to what? Begin to prioritize. And that's the problem, I think, that many times we have, that we fail to what? We fail to plan. We don't put God in that role that he should be in. Scripture says, seek ye what? First, the kingdom of God, set your affections what? On things above and not on things of the earth. The Bible tells us that if we want to follow Christ, we have to deny ourselves, take up the cross and follow him. He that seeketh to save his life will what? Lose it. And he that what? Loses his life shall what? Shall gain it. And the Bible mentioned also about that if any man that comes after me and hate not his mother, father, sister, brother, wife, and all of that, is not worthy of me. Hate. In other words, I don't mean it literally hate. That means to love more than.
Yeah.
Any man comes after me and he doesn't love God more than his wife, you know, his husband or children, father, mother, whatever, is not worthy of me. Do you believe God is unfair in demanding a priority in the love affair? Why do you think that God? Why do you think that? So some people say, well, does God demand a right to ask us to put him first in everything? Does he demand that right? You're right, okay. So the reason is obvious, right? Because first place, he's the one that what?
He created us.
Right? Mm-hmm. If it went for him, you wouldn't what?
You wouldn't be.
Oh, that's right. So, okay, that's reason number one. Number two is that he has bought us with a price, right? When we missed it, when we were in sin, then what? He rescued us, and he paid an awesome price to redeem us back to God. So we are bought with a price, and the only hope for eternity we have is in what? Christ. And he's the one that paid it, made it possible, paid the price, in order for us to be able to what? To experience life after this life is over. Now tell me if that's not worth, I mean, if that's not enough for him to demand, amen, that our affections be on things above and not on things of the earth. Does that merit that much commitment, that level of commitment? All right. Y'all heard about the story. I'm going to see if I can steer you over that. The little story that I always use about on page 63. It's a good little story that illustrates the fact that God deserves the right to be place at the forefront of our lives. Okay, that on page 463 it says, what right does the Lord have to require believers to lay down their lives for him and for the gospel's sake? Alright, the story goes back. The story of a little boy and his toy sailboat perfectly illustrates the Lord's right to require total commitment from his followers. A little boy proudly and skillfully crafted a toy sailboat in fresh red and white paint. One day when the wind was raging, it escaped the little boy's fingers and swept down the river away from its grief-stricken owner. He looked long and hard for the little boy boat, but all to no avail. Several weeks later, while walking on a downtown street, his eyes caught a glimpse of his bright-colored little sailboat in a pawn shop window. He rushed in and demanded his little sailboat from the shop owner, but was met with an abrupt and disappointing refusal. The little boy had been found. The little boat had been found and sold to the shop owner, and he demanded a set price before he could get it back. Y'all follow that so far? Okay. Sad and disappointed, he walked out with a heavy heart. After making this little beautiful little boat, you know, got away from it, he was very sad because the owner demanded that he would what? Pay for it, because somebody had found the boat and sold it to the what? The man that owned the pawn shop. Okay, with a heavy heart, but determined, he would secure his little boat again at any cost. After a few days, he returned and laid down the money required on the shop owner's counter and demanded his prized possession. This time, he receives it. As he went out of the store down the street with his little toy boat tucked under his arm, he was heard saying tenderly, "You are mine, little boat. You are mine, little boat. You are mine twice. Once because I made you, and twice because I bought you back." That's a good little story, right?
Yeah.
In like manner, we all belong to Christ, once because he made us, and twice because he what?
Bought us back.
All right, so for the love of God constraineth us, because we thus judge if one died for all, that all were dead, and that he died for all, and they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him that died for them and rose again. Hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brother. So after reading the above scriptures describing the sacrifice that God and Christ made for us, we can understand more fully why we are called upon to lay down our lives. God didn't spare his own son, but delivered him up for us, and Christ pleased not himself, but laid down his life for us. We are to be compelled and constrained by the same love. We as believers are not called to live unto ourselves, but to please him who died for us and rose again to redeem us from the hand of Satan and from an awful fate due to our disobedience. All right, so that's a good illustration. What right does the Lord have in telling me what to do? Do you think some people think that way?
Yeah,
what right does the Lord have telling me what to do? I do what I want to do.
Because he made
me. Right. That's right. He created us, and he created us for a what specific purpose. And he has a right, amen, to put all of these different requirements upon us, because we are his, and I guess we're his twice. He made us, and then he what? Bought us back. All right, now, the other thing, isn't that interesting how we are to, our role is to, note 2 says, it's on page 16, what an indictment against God's representatives and ambassadors whose role is to speak on the Lord's behalf and to represent the Lord's interest. Now, those are two things on page 15 that shows that what we're supposed to be all about. No, it's on page 13, I'm sorry. There are two scriptures concerning our responsibility as followers of the shepherd that's not popular today. 1 Corinthians 3:9 and 2 Corinthians 5:20. All right, the first one, 1 Corinthians 3:9, this is page 13 at the bottom, C. We are laborers together with God. 2 Corinthians 5:20, we are ambassadors for who? Christ. An ambassador does two things. Speaks on behalf of the one he represents and promotes the interests of the one he represents. So the call and commission have been clearly stated. We are laborers with him. We are to continue all that Jesus began to do and teach. We are his only representatives or ambassadors on the earth. We are to speak on his behalf, promote his interests, and to do what Jesus would do if he was here on the earth personally. And under D, the primary interest or responsibility we have as believers is to promote the interest of our Heavenly Father. The primary interest of our Lord are the lost, the Holy Spirit baptism, and believers growing up spiritually. Amen. And the text, God's interest in the lost, the Father's interest in the lost, you know, that we can read. Jesus is interested in the lost. The Holy Spirit is interested in the lost. Angels are interested in the lost. That's on page 15. The devil is interested in the lost. And there are only two other groups of being that exist outside of those that we just mentioned. People in hell and human beings. Alright, so we know the devil is interested in the laws, the angels are, God is, the Holy Spirit, all of those are interested. Now what about people in hell? We can see in the story of Lazarus and the rich man that rich man was interested in what? The laws, what? He had some brothers that were what? That was lost, and he was trying to get what? Lazarus to go across that gulf to what? To warn him. Get word to him to not to come to that place where he was. He was in torment. Yeah, everybody familiar with that story? Lazarus and the rich man. Lazarus died. He lifted up his eyes in paradise. But the rich man lifted up his eyes in what? In hell. And there was a gulf between the two. People in hell were in torment, crying and weeping, agonizing. And the people in heaven, they were in what? Bliss, peace, joy, things were going good for them. Just like heaven. That was before heaven. Paradise was underneath the earth before it became established in heaven. And when Jesus rose from the dead, there all of the people that were in paradise, they came out and they ascended. So there's no paradise. When we die now, before Jesus comes, we go to paradise.
Okay.
Our spirits go there, and I wait for the return of Christ when we get our new bodies again. So when Christ comes back for the church, he's going to bring our spirits back with him from paradise. Right? Our bodies are still going to be in the earth. Then our spirits and our bodies are going to what? Reunite. And we're going to be caught up to meet the Lord. And we're going back to heaven to be judged. We'll be spirit, soul, and body in heaven when we get our body back. And then we'll have to give an account. Spirit, soul, and body, you have the same kind of body that flesh, bones, no blood. You'll be invisible. You can touch, feel. You can be recognized, you can talk, you can do everything, but you won't be limited by time or space. In other words, you can appear and disappear. Power of locomotion, you can go out from here, from Tulsa, into London, England, in a split instant. Travel that fast. Travel at the speed of thought. So there will be some changes. Our body will be changed, but yet it'll be a physical glorified being. After Jesus rose from the dead, he was a physical being. He had flesh and bones, but no blood, because the blood had been, you know, shed for the sins of him. Okay. The Bible says flesh and blood will not inherit eternal life. In other words, the same kind of flesh we have now that deteriorates on inherent eternal life. But it will be another type of body that will be a physical body, but it will not be a body that's limited and that will corrupt. It will not be a mortal body that deteriorates like the physical body we have today. But we will be physical beings because we're going to reign with Christ, and there are going to be a whole lot of nations on the earth that we're going to be ruling and reigning over. In other words, we're going to have to do some of the same things that we do for people in this life. We're going to be placed over nations and people. We're going to, you know, reign with Christ, help him to make decisions. We're going to assist him throughout eternity. Okay, but the point is that if you're going to have real natural people like Touch George there, he's in that picture, he'll holler. Okay, so you're going to have people just like us right now that will be over. So we have to be real people too. We just can't be a spirit. People get scared of you if you're just a spirit. So you have to be a real person. So glorified bodies are real bodies. All right. So we got now. What I was trying to get over is that everybody's interested in the laws. Even the people in hell are interested in the laws. The only ones that's not as interested in the laws as we should be would be human beings. And that means that we are, you know, I know that most people are kind of interested in the laws. But you have to go a long ways to find a person that's really, really interested in what the law. Genuinely interested in the law. You have to really kind of search through some folk, right? Because see, that doesn't come just being saved. It doesn't come because you're a minister or a preacher. It doesn't come because you're a pastor or you're an evangelist. And it's something that you have to seek out. Now, what do I mean by, in order to develop an interest, you got to seek it out. What does that mean? Right, you gotta have a desire, and you gotta what?
Seek God.
Right, you gotta put some things in place. Mm-hmm. You gotta put some things in place that will cause you to have a what? Desire for the laws and for people that are perishing. Yeah, this just doesn't come out of man. It's just looking up.
Burdening me down. So in other words, I wasn't just giving it to the Lord. I mean, it was on me strongly. They said that it could make me sick because, I mean, I was just carrying it like a load. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
I was so concerned for my family members being lost and stuff. They said, you got to let that go. You got to give it to God.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So what that means is do the best you can for them, pray for them, and then just cut them loose and give them to God. Right.
Right.
After that.
Okay. I think so. Sister Christian, how you feel about that? You feel really burdened, like Sister Panola was saying. And so what do you do about that? You just sort of...
You have to take it to God in prayer, first of all.
Right.
Because, I kind of look at it in me and Walter's situation, because we kind of feel that way, too, because his family is, you know, that's really like a burden on him and me as well. Just trying to get them to understand that there is a different way. Sometimes, I mean, I hear people say, you know, you got to help those who want to be helped.
Right.
But, I mean, in some cases, you know, they don't seem to want help.
Yes,
but
right.
You still, I mean, to get them to want that desire, you have to pray it into them sometimes. That's how I feel.
Right.
And, I take it to God in prayer, because sometimes if you just sit there and let it be on yourself, you're just going to weigh yourself down and you get depressed about it. And
you sure will.
And it's just going to weigh heavy on you.
You sure will. How you feel about it, Joy? That's good.
That's
good.
The truth right now.
Huh?
That's the truth right now. My brother, man, I wear it back all the time.
Right.
And, you know, I just pray. That's all
right.
I do is deep with God. Pray.
Right. You're Superman. Yes.
Because I noticed that, like right now, you know, even when we were living in Dallas, we're kind of in that same position that they are in, you know, feeling like just helpless, like, you know, nothing's going your way.
Right.
And then now that we, you know, we finally figured it out that, you know, where we really needed to be, what we were missing in Dallas was not being in church.
Right.
So
right.
when we weren't around the word and we wasn't doing, you know, letting the word be effective in our lives,
right.
and we were just like they were, and now that it is effective in our lives, you know, things are working out for us.
Yes.
So it's, to me, it's just you have to lead by example. You have to show them that, hey, when you take this step this way,
right.
it's a lot better.
Yeah, right.
So,
yes, good.
Yeah.
Joe, that's good.
That's true right there.
That's good. Lead by precept and example.
See where I'm at?
Yeah.
My wife praying and crying and everything.
Right. You know, prayer will work. You know, if we take our burdens to the Lord and leave them there, Scripture says for us to be careful about nothing. You know, to be worried or troubled about nothing, but in all things by what? Prayer.
Supplication.
With what? Thanksgiving. Let your request be made what? Known. So there's a way you can release that burden and that care for people in prayer. And sometimes it might require, you know, sometimes fasting. Really good. I remember when I had a case where somebody that was close to me were really sick, and I had been burdened for a long time, and I just made up my mind. I'd been struggling with it. We had gone through every change that we could go through, and we prayed, you know, we sought the Lord, but it seemed like nothing removed that situation, and it was very critical. So I felt like, since I hadn't been able to deal with it, with all of the things that I had done, I thought I would take more of a critical approach to a step. So I began to fast and pray. So I was teaching school at that time. I went through 3 weeks of fasting because I wanted God to speak to me and deal with me, to show me, you know, exactly what I hadn't done and what I needed to do in order to get some results. So after 3 weeks, the Lord spoke to me. He just said, I want you to take authority over this situation. Amen. Go to this person that you're burdened for and take authority over that spirit that's controlling them. I never thought about that, but it took, you know, fasting and prayer for God to just show me. You know, sometimes God can't show you nothing until you what? You kind of bring yourself in subjection. Is that right?
Yes.
Although he wants to get you out of it, but many times he can't. The only way God can communicate things to you, he has to do it through our spirit. He has to reveal and show us. And if you're not in a position for God to show you some things, sometimes, you know, his direction can't be released or revealed to you. So when God showed me, he said, take authority. Then he told me one more thing to do. I did both of those, and that turned that situation completely around. And after all of those years, I've been struggling with that. But just like Derek always said, he said, one day of grace, why does it go better than 1,000 years? But one day of favor is better than 1,000 years of labor or something like that. It's better than 1,000 years of labor. So God can just come in and change things so quickly. So that brings us to the point where we need to be in a position where God can work through us, and we can get these various things released. We gotta find a way to get some results. We just gotta find a way, because it's too much is at stake. People's souls throughout eternity is at stake. And the Bible says God is going to hold us what? Accountable. And so we can see how the drift is going now. The drift is now is that God is interested in the laws. Jesus is what? Interested. He was interested to the point that he what? Laid down his life. God sent Jesus, his only begotten son. And he was willing to what? To give up his only begotten son. Jesus was willing to what? Give his life. The Holy Spirit is interested because the Holy Spirit is sent to us to be a guide, to be a leader, to a teacher. Everything that Jesus was to be while we were here on earth, while he was here on earth, the Holy Spirit is that person that does all of those things right now for us. So that shows the Holy Spirit is really what? He's interested in us. He's really very interested. Now angels, because angels are what? Ministering spirits. They are sent forth to be, to minister to those that will be heirs of salvation. How many have ever felt the influence of an angel in your life? Some kind of presence around you. Amen. You knew it was, it wasn't you, but it was some kind of what? Presence. Recognize his angel. You know, some people don't even know they got one.
Yeah. Guardian angels be ready to protect me all the time because I know that, and it's, you know, I'm not going to take up a lot of time. But we was living in this apartment one time, and I had went to, we had a Wednesday conference 3 days, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, twice church on Sunday. And then this Monday night, I was just tired of kind of winding down for it, you know. And so my husband went to pick him up, but he was like, do you want to go with me? I said, no, I'm so tired. I mean, I'm exhausted, so I stayed home and went to sleep. And during the time that he was gone, some young guys that live out in the place, in the apartment, it wasn't a place, it was just some apartments. They was breaking in people's houses out there, but we had no idea that they was going to break in our house, so we had an empty room back there. And they threw a brick through that storm window and came in. I was so tired and knocked out, I didn't hear nothing. I mean, I was exhausted, you know what I'm saying? And so when he came home, and I heard a little noise. My room door was cracked, and I was in there in the bed asleep. And so they had to come to the front room because they took his, some of his PlayStation and stuff. But I know they seen me in there in the bed. And bottom line is that I know that the guardian angels protected me that night because George was saying, well, you should have snuck up and got to a phone and called me. But God did the best thing for me that he could have did that night, because if I had went up in there on them and startled them or anything, it could have killed me. Anything could have happened. And God was protecting me. The angels was around me while I was in that bed sleep, because we had like stone statues in front of people. They could have took one of them and just knocked me over the head with it. And like, when it happened, I really didn't just think about it like that, but like the second day or something, I really thought about, my God, you know, that's a frightening experience. And that was a couple of angels around me protecting me. They had to be.
The angel also restrained you because if you knew who stole it.
Yeah, I probably would have been possible.
Well, thank God for your ministry to what? Angel. Amen. Amen. Anybody else know if I remember any incident in which you know an angel intervened?
We
kind of
joke about it. When the kids, you know, they almost hurt themselves and say, oh, I know it's an angel.
Right.
Had to been there. Like one day in Elizabeth was, I had a stool sitting up next to the window, and it was actually just a couple of months ago, and she was sitting on it, and just as soon as I said get down, she fell back toward the window and could have flew out the window, but instead, and I told my mother, I said it obviously was an angel there, because the only thing they hit was her hair. They caught the window and they pulled her hair out. She has a bald spot right now, that's to this day, on the back of her head. But it had to have been an angel, because she was on the stool and the stool was right up against the window. So she fell straight back and could have just went straight through the window. And I tell my mother, I mean, we joke about it all the time, but I know that there's angels. I mean, it's obviously evident, especially with my kids, because they do some of the weirdest things sometimes. And you're like, oh, Lord, how did you make it from the porch to the ground? And didn't have a scratch, didn't lose anything, didn't bust his head or anything like that. So I know that there's always angels camping around us. So.
Oh, that's right. Scripture says the angels of the Lord, and the angel of the Lord, is camping around about them and fear it. And all of those years, Brother George, amen, you was roping and roping around, ranting and all that, and Sister Penola had them angels. She said the angels.
schedules out. Order your life in a way that these distractions and all of the things that come to get us off track won't have the that particular ability to do it. And just like today, we mentioned that you got to separate yourself from ungodly people if you're going to live sanctified. If you're going to, if the things of God is going to be meaningful to you, you just can't be hanging around all of the people that's taking you further from God, people that have other interests. you can't kind of where you're going to ever expect to get closer to God when you got people all around you that you're hanging out with, or you have intimate relationships with, that's what? That's saying, cursing every word and every other word and lying and cheating. You know, they're doing all kind of damnable things, and they're going to talk about that kind of stuff around you. And that's going to what? Take you further away. It's going to defile or corrupt your what? Mind.
It will.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to cuss to talk to me.
Right. That's right.
But, you know, he was like, well, remember back then you used to be with the devil, Steve.
Yeah.
This
yeah.
is now.
Right. That's what they
I changed myself.
Right.
You know, and I don't cuss no more.
That's true.
I told you around my wife sometimes, I said, man, you don't need to cuss around my wife.
Right.
You know.
That's good. That's good. And they're going to kind of, you know, take you through some changes when you make up your mind that you're going to go a different direction. That's all right, too.
I tried to get him to come to church with me. Mm-hmm. He said he'll come to me, and I know he got something else to do, so I didn't
come. Right. Right. Right.
Even God.
All right. Well, evil, you know, evil people, well, you have, you can't, you know, you got to deal with them to some.
Yeah, a certain point.
To a certain point. Yeah. But not hang around and listen to all that, the garbage that's spewing out of their mouth. Amen. And partying with them and hanging out and driving around town and. And, you know, and getting involved in all of the stuff, you know, you don't want to do all that. But when you have to have a relation, you know, have to have contact with them, you're just trying to limit, you know, your contact as much as you can and just try to escape the environment. Escape, okay. And evil influences would be things that come on television, things that take so much of our time. You know, if we continue in this vein, we will never come to the point where the things of God is going to mean a whole lot to us. So we got to really begin to, as we said, the old school, live sanctified. You got to start, what, separating yourself from things that really are, what, pulling you down, or taking you in a direction that, what, causing you to, what, lose out. Losing. A lot of times people are losing out little by little. You know, there are a whole lot of people losing out a lot by lot. Okay, so... So it's separation, you know, from, you know, all of these different factors that you got to, so that means that you have to determine what it is that's going to build me up. What can I do that will bring me closer to God? And then I think that it would be good for us to begin to what, make that a part of our what routine. Get it into our what schedule. Amen. Amen. I know one thing I have to do, I have to stop, I cut down on the news. All this new, like that Trayvon, Martin, whoever. I mean, some people listen to that over and over and over. We don't need to be listening to that stuff over and over and over. Amen. So, Scripture says that we are to, let me say that's a good scripture. It says, have nothing to do with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. So, we need to kind of watch what we watch on TV. How many can say amen?
Amen. Amen.
Watch all that kind of stuff. And for God's sake, let's find time to read the what? Bible.
Bible.
And work out Bible lessons, you know. All right, y'all see these lessons here? All right, now I'm trying to get y'all's minds drawn in. So take some time to start working these lessons out. Amen. It wouldn't hurt to start back with lesson one and just work through the whole thing. Right now, we're going to lesson two. But it's good to read. So a good student will automatically what go further than you what. You're not like the wheelbarrow. You won't go no further than you what push. Some people won't go no further than they what push. So a good student will always what go that extra mile. So that means that you work out the whole thing, because working out this book here will absolutely change your life. Because all of the different prayers are in this book. All of the different ways you need to pray. It's all you need. I mean, you can do this for yourself. You don't have to have a teacher. Every page, Pastor Hill is there teaching. Amen. So read this, work it out, go through it, and I guarantee you your life will take a different turn. You will absolutely be a new person. Amen. So that would be your assignment. Because because as long as we, you know, take so much time on TV and so much time on other stuff and take no time for stuff like this. I know Sister Hill, this morning, I noticed that she was really broken over here. She almost broke her toe last night. It was my fault. Came in from Arkansas, left a bag right by the stairway. And she was going down with no lights. She just stopped. She, her toes, her four toes, they just bent back like that. She's already been broken. I feel so bad about it. I brought her bag in, and I just, you know, I was so tired after driving about 100-some miles. So I just laid it down, and I forgot to move it, and she tripped over it, and she hurt it. I felt bad. I don't think she was crying because of that this morning, but she was just broken. But here's the thing I've noticed about her. Sometimes I get kind of jealous because I spend a lot of time doing stuff like this, writing. So I still get the word, but she just have had a practice of reading the Bible through. So I suggest that you try to read every day. If you don't read the whole Bible, it would be good to just do the New Testament. Just try to read every day as much as you can. And if you can't read every day, try to spend some time working through stuff like this. You'll learn a whole lot, and that will stick with you. And these principles will begin to get, you know, established in your life. But I noticed that she seemed like 2 or 3 hours a day. I guess it's just me trying to keep up with the Old Testament reading and New Testament reading. And this morning I was noticing that, and I've been noticing that a while, how broken she is in prayer. I mean, how easy it is for her to just get released. So all of that is important. You know, if we really want to get into the flow of the Spirit, we're going to have to, let's give the Word more time. All right? And a good way to do it is by reading your Bible and working out lessons. If you work this one out, maybe if you work this one out, in the next 2 or 3 months, I might just give you another one to work out. I got a whole lot of them like this. And if you work them out, it's almost like going to a Bible school. I mean, you're going to learn a whole lot because most of us, I got it right. So it's just like going to a Bible school. So I got a whole bunch of books like this with lessons, self-explanatory. All you have to do is read it. The explanations are there. Then you look up a question, write down the answer, and then you come away with a complete picture. Very, very good. So I just wanted you to make sure that you have all of these blanks filled out next week, and we can discuss those questions at the end of chapter 2. Okay. And I'm going to work on all of these people that didn't show up. We had about 30-some that showed up. See, a whole lot of them showed up Wednesday night because they didn't want to come. It's like 5 more. And it's only about 5 of us here today, so I got a long ways to go. It's a big job. Because people get comfortable when they just come once per week on Sunday. They get comfortable with that, and then they are not willing, or maybe they don't have the time or the commitment to go that extra mile. Amen. So next time we're going to spend about 15 or 20 minutes in prayer so we can be out of here about 6:15. And we just want you to just bow your head just for a moment. I enjoyed y'all today. Hey, man, I got to take more time to listen to y'all. Y'all got some good stories.
Good experiences. So have the questions answered.
Yeah, right. Have them answered. So y'all can do all of that for me next week. We're going to try to pull some new people in here to make it a little bit more interesting. And I enjoyed y'all. Y'all were good. Lord, Father, tonight we thank you for your grace. And help us, Father, to set aside time so that we can get into the flow, so that we can begin to feel what you feel and to have the interest that you have. Lord, we want to be pleasing. We want to be sincere and without fault. A heart void of all offense toward God and toward men. We want to be, we want to have perfect hearts, and we don't want to be ashamed of your coming, but we want to know that we have carried out your will and your plan for our lives. And the only way we can do that is that we got to begin to plan. We got to begin to prioritize. We got to begin to make the things that you are interested in a part of our daily routine. Lord, I believe that if we could just spend that time, whatever time that it is convenient for us, to set a time to read over the lessons and to work out the answers. Hallelujah. Father, I believe that that would be a beginning of getting established in holiness and getting established in grace. Hallelujah. Father, even while we're praying, while we are reading the Word and reading the New Testament, the book of St. John is the one that we suggested that we would start reading. Hallelujah. As we read through that, much of the information in the book of St. John will correlate with the information that we're studying in this particular book. Amen. The profile of a true disciple. All of the things that a true disciple should be, hallelujah, committed to doing and to begin to, amen, to get established in their lives. Fathers, help us, God, to grow closer as we begin to get into the Word, as we begin to learn more about you and know your ways and the things that you're interested in. Help us, Father, even to pray. Yes, pray more. Pray in the Spirit. Pray in every minute that we have. Pray singing psalms and hymns and making melody in our hearts to you, Lord. Lord, we're going to begin to exhort them to begin to pray always. Yes, pray, hallelujah, unconsciously. Pray and singing. Pray and making melody in our heart. Praying in the Spirit. Singing in the Spirit. Singing the Word. Singing the psalms. Things that we know. Yes, Father, we believe as we begin to be filled with the Holy Ghost. Yes, halamokoria sata. And even pray in the Holy Ghost as we drive here and there. Just pray in the Spirit, sing in the Spirit, making up these songs. Yes, hallelujah, so that we can fill ourselves with the power and the anointing of God. Father, then we can begin to draw closer and we can come close to being all that you have called us to be. Father, we give you the praise and the glory. In Jesus' name, help us, Father, to reach out to others and to encourage them to come and to hear the word of the Lord. Father, we give you the praise and the glory.